This man, Peter Brock, is about to present a unique view of one of the world's great motor races. He is preparing to start Australia's James Hardy 1000, his car fitted with a television camera that will beam pictures direct to an international audience of millions. It'll be some view and some ride. Come along, because it's an experience you won't forget. The James Hardy 1000 five times. To attempt a sixth victory under the watchful eye of an all-seeing television camera will add a new dimension to his attack on this classic endurance event. It will dramatically increase the already heavy pressures on the man, the car, and the team. Any mistake, no matter how slight, will be seen by a vast number of people.
Really, it's simple and how it actually works, and it's well-tried technology. The control center transmits a UHF radio signal first to the racing car. That signal controls the pan and tilt head. The pictures taken from that are then transmitted by a microwave beam up to the helicopter, which flies usually at about 1,000 feet above the car. That's then retransmitted by microwave beam back to a remote tracking site. That tracking site takes those pictures and brings them back to the control center, where that then is retransmitted to you, and you see that on your TV.
And what about the, if you just put your hands on the normal driving position, we'll see if we can see that instrumentation.
The race cam development by the Seven Television Network engineers in Australia is a stunning technical breakthrough. Small and light, yet able to withstand the enormous stresses that will be fed into the Marlboro Holden dealer team Commodore of Peter Brock as he drives 1,000 kilometres, equal to a lifetime's motoring by any normal driver. Although Brock is a man of strong confidence in his own skills, he admits to some reticence about having a camera watching his every race day move. But he accepts the strictures. After all, his entire approach to motor racing is founded on technical progress, and the race cam will enable him to show the massive audience that the James Hardy 1000 is anything but an armchair ride. And the James Hardy 1000 is something no race driver will ever get used to. Practice is barely underway before the strongly favoured team of Bartlett and Bond suffers a crippling blow in a high-speed crash. It's a situation Brock has witnessed many times before. They will now struggle to make the start line. When the time nears for Brock to go for his fastest time, he forces himself to ignore the misfortunes of others and concentrate on his own performance. It will also be a full-scale test of the race cam installation.
169.
Everything has to be just right, and the attention being lavished on the second Marlboro Holden dealer team car of Harvey and Scott mirrors the work that has gone into Brock's machine. The team is confident they will earn the fastest qualifying slot.
172.
So, Brock starts his qualifying lap. The camera is ready to record his every move.
0.
Brock's struggling with the wheel as he goes round hill corner now and heads up mountain straight. Incline here so deceptive because the cars really are climbing very rapidly, approaching somewhere in the vicinity of 200 kilometers per hour, flying towards the top of Mountain Straight. Shortly, the brakes will come on, he'll change down and head into GTX Bend. There he goes. Now the real climb starts up Mount Panorama. Tail out just a little bit as Brock goes around the bend there, into the cutting. Grades here as steep as 1 in 6. This is what really strains the big cars going up the mountain. The left-hander, very good line, and they're perfect. A lot of cars have been hanging the tail out at that point. Brock getting up towards the top of the mountain now. 1 minute gone in this lap. He's looking for a time of, well, it'll have to be about a 2.18, I would think, to put him on pole position. There's our race cam inside Brock's car. Look at those hands on the wheel. Really fighting the car across the top of the mountain now. Castrol curve. Coming around to McPhillamy Park, this is one of the most treacherous parts of the circuit. Oh, into the dirt on the side. That's going to cost him precious tenths of seconds.
An enormously minor mistake, but it may have been enough to be the division between first and second fastest qualifying time. But that won't be known for a little while yet.
He now comes off the top of the mountain at Skyline and begins the run down through the dipper. Really is fighting that wheel. Goodness me. The circuit is so fast because for the first time in a couple of years it's dry on Hardy's Heroes Day and the drivers are really pushing their cars to the limit. Big run. Now coming down to Forest Elbow, making the big left-hand sweep, and the horizon opens up on Conrod Strait for Peter Brock. Heading down now at phenomenal speed, probably touching 275 kilometers an hour or even better. Everybody glancing anxiously at stopwatches, myself included, as Brock comes down. And a five-time winner here on the mountain at Bathurst. And he wants to be up there as number one again. Not to mention the fact that it's worth $10,000 in prize money just to be on pole position. Coming down to Murray's Corner, Brock hits the brake. That makes the left-hander. The checkered flag is out at the end of the flying lap for Peter Brock.
I got him out here.
So he might be quicker so far.
Yeah, here in a minute.
217.836.
217.836 for Peter Brock.
And that'll make the Ford fans a little bit down in the mouth.
You know.
708, I believe.
Very happy to lap.
217.836. 3 seconds under the lap record. But is it good enough for the number one start position? Rival Commodore driver Alan Grice wins the pre-race confrontation by just 0.2 of a second. But tomorrow, and race day itself, is a vastly different proposition. Race day is predictable. The marching girls strut, the band plays on, and Air Force jets wheel about the sky. Traditional pomp and ceremony associated with Australia's largest sporting telecast.
Alan Grice, for the first time on pole position, hoping for his first ever win here at Mount Panorama, and alongside him the man who's won five times, would love to make it six times, Peter Brock.
Brock and his arch rival Grice stay aloof from the maelstrom of noise and movement for as long as possible, readying their minds and bodies for the 6 hours of immense effort. But finally, the approaching start time forces them onto centre stage. As the race cam in Brock's car gets a last-minute check, time suddenly runs out. The James Hardy 1000 is about to erupt.
But his heart must be pumping at twice its normal rate. Peter Brock, he'd love to win this race six times. He looks so calm and relaxed, but just talking to Peter, I know that really he's just as nervous as most people, but he shows no signs. He's has an iron will, the way he can control his emotions, and all he's thinking about at the moment as he tries to concentrate on the task these next few hours is winning this race. The most important race in Australia.
The seconds rush by. The drivers and their cars are locked into a countdown that will end in only one of them being able to claim victory and mastery of Bathurst and the James Hardy 1000. Seconds to go. Can Brock do it? Can he stave off the challenge from Grice and record a history-making sixth win? The questions are about to be answered.
And so the flag is raised, the start is near, the last nervous seconds before the start of the James Hardy 1000. Engines are throbbing. You can feel the crowd vibrating with emotion. It's the big moment. The race is about to start.
The start for 1,000 on the inside.
So it begins, this great and amazing journey. From the outset, Grice throws out the challenge. The coveted pole position has given Grice the better line into the crucial first corner, and he holds on to first place as the roaring avalanche of cars climbs the mountain for the first time. But Brock is close. These first laps will be almost frightening in their intensity.
The Recar Commodore heading up to the cutting. Wait for the cheers across the top of the mountain as Sydney's Alan Grice leads Peter Brock, then Kevin Bartlett in the 9 V8 Camaro.
Crowd rise to their feet as they tumble down the other side of the mountain.
The spectacle is immense. The drama almost overpowering as Brock readies to challenge.
Lap 1 of the James Hardy 1000. Grice is still in front, but Brock in the straight, a rising bit of beat, the cheers are beginning already.
He leads lap number 1 of the James Hardy, but Brock this time. Lead away from Alan Grice in the Recar Commodore.
And you were there when he did it. Peter Brock carrying the race cam, got by Alan Grice at the end of lap 1. There's the view out the back, Grice is making a charge up mountain straight, he's coming close, you can see. That's the passenger's view. Grice weaving around, picking up undertow. He's quick up the hill. Now he pulls on the inside. We'll follow him through. Oh, he can't quite hold him. Side by side, they've got the mountain. No, he says, I haven't got the legs. They're coming up towards Castrol Curve. Through they go, up towards the cutting. Brock's in front. Grice pulls out the pass. Comes up on the outside of him. Brock can see it. Grice is going through into the cutting. He's going hard and deep. A second gear corner this. A dab of brakes. Up with the brakes and hard. Who goes the wider? Brock in very close. Out wide to the fence. A little bit wider line. Up they come towards McPhillamy now. Up the mountain. And Brock is going on the inside. There's the crowd. And Grice, though, still in front. It's a two-car war between these long-time rivals. They are using up all the track and a little bit more. And it's once again Alan Grice who will lead across the top of the mountain. And the crowd are roaring with excitement. Inside the car with Peter Brock. He's working hard. Now he comes to Skyline, a frightening part of the second. Down he goes. Rub on the tail of Alan Grice.
Oh, the pace is fearsome here. Standing lap off the start. Full tanks of fuel, 125.94. Those speeds are coming down. The speeds are going up rather. The times are tumbling down. As these two come in front of Hammer and Tom.
Tail gaining is Peter Brock to Alan Grice. Grice leads down Conrod Strait. And now we'll see if Brock can pull aside.
He's closing a bit though. He is definitely closing now. He's
down they plunge. The two leaders centimetres apart as their Commodores reach out toward 300 kilometres an hour. An unthinkably fast speed.
180 miles an hour. But will he try and outbrake him? Yes, he will. Going a little deeper, coming towards the bridge, into the braking area. Oh, that takes some
again,
nerve.
They roar on to start-finish straight. And Brock this time is not so close. The Grice challenge is powerful. And outright confrontation with all the attendant dangers of mishap is not the way to attack these opening laps. Brock will stay close, but play a waiting game and rely on his pit crew to monitor any thrust against his own position from behind. As the two leaders climb the hill again, the breathless pace is having a profound effect on some of the field. As the pits clutter with faltering machines, only Harvey, Bartlett, and the defending Bathurst winner Johnson are in sight of the leaders. But the gap is stretching. The Marlborough Holden dealer team pits learn of a three-car crash on the mountain. Three less opponents to worry about. There's no room for sentiment in the James Hardy 1000. More drivers head for the pits, and as the fierce Harvey Bartlett-Johnson struggle continues, the race is about to reach out and slap down the leader.
Car very well. He gets on well with him.
Oh, he's gone!
Grice spins. The pressure has finally told.
Grice is gone.
He'll get going again, but the loss is 10 seconds, and the rhythm of the car is disturbed. The Grice challenge is all but finished. Brock has maintained the pressure, and Grice has succumbed. It's as simple as that. The electric eye watches as the Marlborough Holden dealer team Commodore sweeps up the mountain. For lap after lap, Brock takes his massive television audience into the rarefied world of the professional race driver. As they watch the supreme car control, the deft balance between eye and lip, there can be no doubt that they are watching a champion at work. A man who, in his fierce desire for victory for his Commodore, is spread-eagling the field, crushing it into disarray and submission. The strain on the rest of the field is intense. It's about to claim another victory. It blows tragic, numbing, emotional.
Dick got out of the way, but the back tire is off. The back tire is off.
The Bartlett crash removes the last remote threat to Brock's sixth Bathurst win. The race is not even a third over, yet the Brock Commodore has already dramatically thrust aside all opposition. It's a display of stunning strength.
Oh, this is a great shame for a team that worked so hard. Colin Bond crashed the car and virtually wrecked it earlier in the week. But after all the work to get this car to the racetrack, Kevin Bartlett is out of the race.
Colin, what do you think happened?
Well, just watching the replay, it was obvious that when Kevin got out of the car, he looked at the rear tyre, and the rear tyre was flat. And when you watch on the replay, the car comes into shot absolutely out of control and sliding. And I think what it's actually done, the tyres would be worn out, but he's probably picked up a stone or something. But there's a lot of debris that gets left on the circuit from other cars and just hitting things. And the tyres just gone flat, and there was nothing you could do about it. Brock and his car lunge down the straight. The race is about to change pattern as the leader prepares to stop for fuel and tyres and hand over to co-driver Larry Perkins. Is quick and efficient. Grice has now lost so much ground that he's not in a position to pass, and the lead Commodore will get back out onto the track without losing first place. But there is a nagging worry with a sudden disclosure by the team's chief mechanic.
We ran the car completely out of fuel, which meant we had to put a fourth churn in, which takes that just a little extra time to do. Normally we'll drop three in because there's about a gallon or so left in the car.
Was that planned to run the car dry?
So, yeah, well, we had to get maximum laps so we'd only have three pit stops rather than that extra one at the end. And that's how we planned it, for sure.
Perkins settles into the mid-race rhythm. Harvey completes his stop and joins Brock for a rest.
Your car went all right, mate?
The two Marlborough drivers are delighted with the performance of their cars and have few doubts that they will be able to dispense with any late challenges.
As a matter of fact, he...
Resting they may be, but there's no mental relaxation a few metres away in the Marlborough pits as the mechanics closely watch the position of the cars. Slip by. Brock's rest nears its end. Grice remains well behind, and while some people fight hard to retain a modicum of concentration as the race's middle stage draws to a close, the casualties keep mounting. Brock, ever cautious, despite the evidence of the effects of the searing pace on his opposition, is still not quite ready to claim victory.
Second half of the final session, how's it look?
seems to be pretty good at the moment. I know we've got a car that's pretty well unburstable. We've been driving it fairly quietly all day in terms of the available revs and available tyre wear and brake wear. But it's a long way to go. But hopefully, if we just keep stroking the car along, I think we can withstand any challenges that might get thrown at us. Keep out of trouble. We're looking good.
If you win, it'll be your sixth win. How will you feel about that?
Well, I don't know. Until you win there, you're fairly apprehensive this stage of the day, of course. But no, I guess you feel pretty impressed about it all because I think you only get out of a victory what you've actually put into it in the first place. And we put a hell of a lot into it this year.
Grice is now even more distant. Although he will be interested to learn of the problems that almost halted Brock's co-driver at the top of the mountain.
I ran out of petrol just over the top of the hill when I should have ran out way down the hill. So apart from that fuel problem, it was fine. We'll just have to make sure Brock, he drops off one lap shorter than I did then.
Did you get a fright?
Oh, I don't know about a fright, but I was very relieved. It was 100 yards the right side of the top of the hill as opposed to the wrong side of the hill.
In other words, had it run out the wrong side, you could have been stuck up there.
Yeah, I'd say I could have been up there having a beer with the boys the way it was looking, yeah.
I'm quite sure that hopefully I can get up to second and we can have a 1-2.
Well, John, there's absolutely no doubt that these cars have really flayed the field.
Well, they have, but to be fair, I'd have to say that some of our competitors are not having a very good day. There is no doubt that the Commodores are running well. We've done our homework and everything's been working well. Pit stops have been excellent. So we're looking excellent for a 1-2.
The potential fuel shortage is worrying. The only blight on an otherwise dominating and near-perfect race. Perkins and the mechanics decide to alter strategy to stave off the horrifying possibility of the Commodore running dry.
Just worries me doing 39 laps. There's no way you can afford to run the same number of laps that I did, because assuming he's going to use more juice than me, he might be on the gas more. If I ever ran 100 yards shorter, we'd be still up there.
Yeah.
Like, it's too big a risk. It's a gamble, you know?
Okay, well, we'll shorten it off, then we have to make the last one.
The decision is made. Bring him in early. Brock, 3 minutes ahead of Grice, isn't concerned. He can afford to lose some time in the pits. He has another reason for not objecting to the stop. The lowering late afternoon sun is making conditions uncomfortable, and he needs to slake his thirst. Perkins helps cool the race leader by putting ice down the back of his neck. Television commentators tell their audience what's happening as the last churn of fuel empties and it's time for the last run to the flag. With little more than 30 laps remaining, Brock's team is now prepared to think in terms of that win.
We'll run through to the finish. We have made 40 laps and we've only got 38 to go, so we'll do it easily.
Now, is the pressure still on?
For sure, yeah. We just want to stay where we are. We'll run the same lap times and to the finish if it's possible.
What about Grice? Is he a threat?
He's a lap and a half behind.
Now, how's Harvey going?
He's catching Grice slowly, but we'll only have to wait and see as to what happens there.
So there could be a 1-2?
We're hoping for it.
Harvey, now running a strong third and in a position to threaten Grice for second, also makes his last stop. It's been a sound, supportive effort by the team veteran. As Harvey leaves the pits for the last time, he, like Brock, knows there is still time for problems to strike. The problems that continue to cut down other competitors. The attrition rate of this James Hardy 1000 has been heavy. Only a third of the starters have made it to the finish line. half is an emotional affair for Brock and his team. This sixth win they will remember as one of their finest. A win that saw them stave off a strong challenge and then crush and dismay their opponents. This is the way it was at Bathurst 1982. For Brock, his Marlborough team and Commodore, and the television audience of millions that rode with them all the way.
This will be a great win for Peter Brock and for the Holden Commodores, which really have dominated this race. For the last of the 163 laps, he comes into the braking area. He's going to win it.
He's done it. He's won it. The 82, James Hardy, 1,000, it goes to Peter.